generally what they did, would have done, is go in on bedrock, okay? And I dug down a foot and a half. I thought I'd have, you know, this is filled in a little bit. He's kind of reclaimed that. He mined this and filled it in. Well, we really didn't hit anything. Two or three years later, he came back to the site, and we were, we were a foot away. Another foot, and there was, as I predicted, which it should have been, the old timers were not dumb. They were going in on bedrock, see? So, and he started getting a fairly good gold, and then it kind of petered out. But he kept expanding, but look at all, this is his hand mining. All the value, he had to knock all this down, and then the values were on bedrock. So bedrock is pretty close to, it's maybe only a foot or so below this at the most, okay? But that's what he was doing, is going in on bedrock. It looks like that's yours.
Probably must have fell out of my pocket. Yes. Well, I pulled my camera out of my pocket.
Okay, when I saw the 821 on it, that's a day old. That wasn't an old trash left here. So essentially my plan of operations is for this bench over here.
Or you can get down to the
bottom. Yeah, I can get, you know, it's not extremely deep. Well, we're still, there's still some depth here a little bit, but it's, the other advantage, no water, see?
Right.
I'm up here, I don't have a water issue. I'm above the creek, and I'm not going to be flooded.
Right.
So, and I said it, essentially it's a sampling. One in three, one in four chances there'll be enough value that I want to mine the whole bench. You know, I told I was up front with the Forest Service. Why I don't know, but they wanted about $3,000 bond, and I've still been looking for a partner that has someone wanted to kind of get an education. I wanted to, for safety reasons, someone that had a backhoe. And I had a perfect guy in Helena, but his backhoe was too small. He really wanted to learn and do this, but I haven't turned up the right partner yet. But that's what the old timers did. Now, here's something I learned years ago. I had a D7 and a big excavator south of Butte. And I was fun with it. I don't have much heavy equipment time, but I took that D7 and trenched. I was about 7-8 feet deep, and I cross cut some of the drift mines. Okay. And my thought is, if they're drift mine, if drift mine's expensive, there's good values there. What I really learned, it was a real education. There wasn't anything there. Some of these guys were doing it is strictly prospecting, gambling, and they were tunneling like badgers. And because I opened up the drifts, I sampled right next to it, and no real values. So sometimes the old timers went to a tremendous amount of effort
for nothing.
So just because you see this drift mine doesn't mean he took a ton of gold out of here.
He was open to, and the
value is this is some of the best ground my partner got into, and for some reason it was kind of sporadic and it petered out, but he was when he was down on bedrock cleaning this out, he was doing fairly good. But again, not really making, hand mining, you don't make any money, but he was filling up his little while, and doing better than playing in tailings. But that was an education in view. Generally that's natural. If you're going to go that much trouble underground drift mining, there's something there. Well, there was up above, because it's so extensive, and you see all that washed gravel. They didn't do that for their, for exercise. So they were, sustaining themselves. But that maze of drifts in Butte. And it wasn't that deep. Well, it was about 7 feet. And the drifts weren't that, you know, today, you know, no one would drift mine only 7 foot overburden. You'd have a cap and take it off, exactly. But that was...
Can I ask you a question?
Oh, certainly. This is your day.
Were you down there in the Chinaman diggings south of you?
Up in the highlands.
Oh, you were up in the highlands?
In the highlands, yeah.
Where, did you go as far up as Moose Town?
I don't recall that. I was up... I was doing a sampling job for, I forget their name, there was a cabin up there with, they had a hydroelectric plant on. They were living on what was their name? The gal was 80 some years old, widowed, and the Forest Service trying to kick her out. Stratton's.
Yeah.
The Stratton Mill. Okay.
Okay, I know
they,
where
but,
you
were. But what they wouldn't listen. When her husband passed, her husband was a legitimate miner, you know, prospector, and when he passed away, you know, well, they were also running a sawmill. They had a hydroelectric plant. They had heating elements for their dog on the porch. You know, they were burning up all kinds of electricity from this hydro plant, beautiful hydro plant, but it was all on an unpatented mining claim. And they had a mill site, her husband was developing, but he kind of passed away. I said, you're not legitimately mining anymore. You're subject to the Forest Service going after you and trespass. I said, you try to get someone to work with you as, you know, maybe exchange for finishing the mill and running the mill for samples or something. These were hard rock samples in this case. He had some crushers and he had the free power with the pellet wheel. But they never really legitimized it, you know, so they weren't actually mining it, and so she was, you know, and they ended up booting her off, and they were going to go to court, and the judge was sympathetic to the Forest Service, and they just went along with the summary judgment. You know, the government attorney said this doesn't even need to be a court, you know, they didn't even get their chance a day in court, and they were trying to represent themselves, but. They didn't have much of a leg to stand on. But it was also their claims where they were leasing out that 27 ounce nugget came off of, and that's in the museum there
mm-hmm.
at Montana Tech.
Mm-hmm.